I've never been much of a painter. I certainly can't draw to save my life. But today we'll meet somebody who not only paints, they paint with their mouth and years of determination. They've gotten pretty darn good at it at that. So why don't you hop in and travel with me? My name is JB Sauceda. This is Texas Country Reporter.
I didn't study art. I mean, you know, in a classroom kind of thing. Like I've flipped through art books my whole life and was around that. And so I started with paper and black and white and just like, here's 25 smiles, here's noses, eyes.
There's a unique language that's spoken through art, one that's cultivated and perfected over time. Artists use long brushstrokes and deep hues of paint to share their story. But Jared Dunton's journey into the art world didn't start with paintbrush in hand. It started with paintbrush in mouth.
It was trial and error. Like, let's try a paintbrush, just a paintbrush. Stick it in your mouth. Well, it's too small. Like, it's not long enough. You know, problem solving, right? So like the brush, I can't hold it without altering it some way because, you know, you have it right between your teeth. Mm-hmm. And it's too short. And then you've got problems with control and it's a mess. And it's like, well, that doesn't work. And that's what has continued even to this day. And I'm still like, well, I don't like that oil. And the brush isn't right. Or it's not the brush I want, or it's too short or too long.
What are the subjects or the things that you like to paint?
I'm painting everything.
Like really? What portraits.
It's really like, yeah, sure.
Landscapes.
Yes.
Airplanes.
Yes.
All house. Of
it.
Yeah.
All of it.
Jared's portfolio is filled with everything from painted palms to peonies. His lifestyle, subject, and technique has evolved over time, and from his humble studio just outside of Austin, he continues to grow as an artist. With the utmost precision, he masterfully maneuvers the brush with his mouth, maintaining meticulous lines while mulling over memories of the past. And reflecting on the day, his life changed forever.
So you and I met a long time ago, my early days in Central Texas through a mutual friend, Marty Butler, mm-hmm. And you all were out in Big Bend, right?
Yeah.
Y'all used to go out there a decent amount.
Marty and I were in a very special place, which is also a very powerful place. The desert's one of those things that feels like you can live or die there, and you have to respect it. I think that's the big thing with nature. God, the earth, everything is, you have to respect that. Uh-huh. And the second that you don't, you get humbled.
Well, so in Marty's telling, y'all were on the Rio Grande.
Yep.
And we're enjoying a camping trip and mm-hmm. you grabbed a bar of soap or something to dive in and take a bath, right?
I was gonna jump in after a soak in the hot springs.
The hot springs.
I was gonna jump in the Rio Grande, which I'd been to the Rio Grande. I knew better. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I dove in and I probably tried to dive a little flatter, but I hit a sandbar, I think.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. That's what I've been told.
Jared's memory of that day will forever be a little foggy. But it was Marty who saved him, jumping into the river to pull up his lifeless body. After months in the hospital, they discovered his neck was broken and that his life would never be the same.
As far as the implications for you, I mean, because of that, now, you, what can you do, what can't you do?
So, I mean, at the moment, I can lean forward like this. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the most movement. There's some bicep. I could, like, make a kick-ass muscle in both sides. Huh. I had this idea of, like, you know, in all these movies, you see people rehabbing, and they're, like, struggling and fighting on the parallel bars. And I was like, that's, I'm going to be doing that for a while. So it's really going to be a hiccup in my professional life. It's like, it's going to be like 6 to 8 months probably. Huh. And then as I'm like getting further along and I'm getting better, it became more of like, oh, this is going to take a lot longer than I thought.
Wow.
I'm still shocked. We're talking, what, 24 years later, and I'm still like, I'm way off schedule, man. This is like 20 years more than I thought it was going to be.
Although Jared's still a bit off schedule in his healing, learning to paint after his injury made all the difference in the world. He advocates for research for paralysis from spinal cord injuries and wants his story to be told and the belief in a cure to be spread. And he says he'll continue painting masterpieces till the day he walks again.
What does painting do for your soul?
It feeds it. I think it shapes. It strengthens. Oh, I think it adds to it. I think it makes it bigger. I think it increases the soul.
Back in Europe, I had a band called Tak TT. They were like number one band in Czechoslovakia. I was on the radio all the time in Europe. So that's what we pay the rent.
If there's one thing Houston isn't short of, it's unique places to dine. But you'll have a hard time finding anywhere else where dinner comes with entertainment by a European rock star turned chef.
And so you're a longtime musician?
All my life. I'm a professional musician until I met Giga, then I have to work now.
Yeah. And he's a musician, and I was never into musicians, so I don't know what happened.
So talk to me about the food. What do you serve here?
Pretty much we take the European dishes. I put my twist on it. And then when we came here everywhere, we've seen Tex-Mex. So we said, why not Euro-Tex? So what does it mean? I said, just put a lot of cheese on it.
Well, there's a bit more going on at Blue Tuba Euro-Tex Cuisine than just putting a lot of cheese on it. The brainchild of Vlado Kalinic and Giga Lezayova, Blue Tuba serves dishes inspired by the countries Vlado toured with his band. The menu deliciously melds together Slovak, Scandinavian, Hungarian, German, and Greek with Tex-Mex influences, creating a dining experience unlike any other.
We are really different. That's why Euro-Tex cuisine is like, this is the first one in the world. Maybe I'm starting the trend, who knows?
We are very European place. I would say like 85% we are European, yeah. Like original classical dishes, and then we added a little Texas fusion in it. We have Slovak tacos, so the tortilla we make in Slovakia, it calls lokša. So the Slovak tortilla is made from potatoes and flour. It's like a 2/3 of potato and a flour. And it's very, very nice. And put a duck fat on it, it's very nice.
Yeah.
What are your favorite dishes that you serve?
Schnitzel is number one.
Schnitzel, really?
Schnitzel, our schnitzel is Texas size. Big.
And so many people, it's very cute to hear people when they say, oh, my great-grandmother did this, my grandfather, and they have like so many people, they get so excited about dishes and they know so much. I'm very surprised, pleasantly surprised. Like how they excited they are about the food, the original European food.
One step, that's the large map of Europe with Texas overlaid, and you've arrived at a culinary destination that could only exist in the Lone Star State. Here, the European and Texas flags hang side by side, while diners chow down plates of Texas paella and Slovak macaroni and cheese. There's no other place quite like this, and for Vlado and Giga, there's no better way to share their Slovakian heritage with the world.
What do you hope people's experience is when they leave? Like, what do you hope people walk away from the restaurant with?
We'll be hoping they come back and they really enjoy. We try to approach every table. I try to go to every table and talk to them, and people really appreciate it. And everybody's so nice, so nice. Everybody, I don't know, everybody's just so nice.
You know, when you go to visit somebody, you always end up in the kitchen. You know, just food is just you can share culture and eat and have no time. I mean, really, it's a food, no, it's not a rocket science. People are loving to it. You know, nowadays everybody's a rock star chef. This looks pretty, but you leave hungry. You know, it just looks nice. So,
do people leave hungry here?
No.
The complaint is too big, which is good.
Hi everybody, I'm Kate and I'm so excited to be here today. I'm so happy to see all your faces and it's time for family time. The goal is truly to build empowering relationships and we wholeheartedly believe in that and believe that they are lasting relationships and not something that's just here, we're friends and then we kind of leave and go out through our days. These are our friends and I truly think about them throughout my life and I look forward to seeing them every Friday.
It's a phrase we've all heard or used ourselves a time or two. Thank God it's Friday. For many, it's that moment that represents the end of the work week and the simple pleasure of knowing there's no alarm set for tomorrow morning. But as exciting as Friday is for most of us, there's probably nobody more thrilled for that day than the group gathered together at Southside Church of Christ in Fort Worth, Texas.
It gets you up every Friday morning. Yeah. We look forward to it just as much. So when they are like counting down the days to Friday, texting me, three more days till Friday, I can't wait to see you. It's just, it really warms your heart. It's unbelievable.
Kate Marshall and Andrew Reitman are an integral part of the Friday morning meetups here between two unlikely groups of people. Students studying at Texas Christian University and people experiencing homelessness all over Fort Worth.
I mean, so we kind of have our tagline, which is really just to build empowering relationships between TCU students and members of our community that are experiencing homelessness.
And they found that like building relationships between these like TCU students and the homeless is like, that's the most important thing, is relationships in life. That's why it's been such a great experience for me, and I can speak for Kate as well on that.
So what happens on Fridays? How does it work?
The food is coffee, donuts, and burritos. So we'll kind of hang out and just chat with everybody what's been going on in their lives, basically like a family would. That's why we call it family time. And then at the end, after we've kind of heard everybody, we will pray over everyone and just voice any concerns that have been discussed. And then we play bingo. It's bingo time!
I love the excitement, enthusiasm. I-16 is our first number.
Known as Bingo in the Park, named for its humble beginnings where it started as an official TCU club that met at nearby Oakland Park, these days the halls of Southside Church of Christ ring out with G56s and B1s. With cards laid out and markers in hand, hearts skip a beat as Andrew calls out each number.
G52.
Every winner is given a Walmart gift card, making the stakes extra high.
Our last bingo winner.
But this is about more than gift cards or the bus passes everyone's given. It's about the unlikely bonds created between the students and those living on the streets. Bonds that Judy Hargan has cherished ever since she first started coming.
Every Friday, 9 a.m., be here for TCU Bingo. It's just a, see this smile?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you lit up.
Those are my kids. Because I look after them like I'm a mother hen. I make sure that they're doing well. They bring a peace to me, and to see them do well and to share the love that they have and see them doing well just makes me smile. I can't stop smiling.
Judy's rarely missed a Friday bingo, making her a strong mother figure for all of the TCU kids. Her journey has taken her from living in a tent to recently getting an apartment. But she'll be the first to tell you that that path wasn't easy.
What are those things that people don't get about?
Well, desperate times call for desperate measures. And a lot of times, and when you're faced with not knowing where your meals are coming from, or everyone is a stranger. I mean, you're a stranger to yourself when you're homeless a lot of times, because it's the nature of the beast. You're vulnerable, and it's dog eat dog, and we're all wearing milk bone underwear out there. We see the homeless as bad or thieves or druggies or, you know. Now, that's true in all walks of life, you know. Sitting in the big houses, driving the nice cars, or just sleeping in your car, not having a car. They just depends on the person.
How did you find the moments of levity when you were having to live on the street like that? How did you stay optimistic?
I mean, look at the sky, the trees that we're breathing. God is so good. And I a long time ago, I decided that I know what pain feels like, and I know what joy feels like, and I'm going to push the joy thing even through my painful moments, because it feels good.
What does it mean to you to come here?
Faith, hope, and love.
Bingo is a simple game, one of chance, but also full of possibilities. A game where people from all walks of life can bond and share stories and find out that they have more in common than they ever imagined. And once the game's over and everyone's gone their separate ways, the countdown begins till next week, where this unexpected family will gather once again.
What do you feel like you've learned, you know, in having done this now for, you know, a while?
I think I learned a lot about myself. I've definitely become a lot more caring, compassionate, a lot better listener. And I mean, I've been doing it for 3 years now. I'm a junior, and it's been one of the most rewarding experiences of my life. And I feel like I've grown so much more in these 3 years than any other years of my life, honestly.
It's totally changed my perspective throughout college. It's something I never really was exposed to growing up, was people experiencing homelessness. So kind of actually not only seeing them on the street, but then actually eating with them and being friends with them and talking to them and knowing their experiences and why they're here and how I can help them get out of the situation that they're experiencing has been just, I wouldn't trade it for anything, and I'm so grateful that I've gotten to have it at TCU.
I feel very blessed. I feel very blessed. This place is not just a building. It's God's got his hand on it, and he's doing a good job.
I saw a lot of laughter today. Is that something that the kids bring to it?
They better. They better if I'm here. They're going to be laughing. We're going to be laughing together, yes. It's a golden rule, because they helped bloom this smile inside of me again. And I owe them that much to keep it going. Because there'll be times when I can't even hardly breathe. And I'll know Friday's coming and I'm better.
As we get older, it can be easy to give the youth of the day a little bit of flack for maybe doing things differently than we would have at their age. But the homeless bingo story that we told today is a great reminder that there's good in every heart, regardless of age, if you look for it. So I look forward to next week, and I hope you'll hop in and travel with us as we continue on this journey down the back roads of Texas. My name is JB Salceda, and this is Texas Country Reporter.